Hi, I'm Jeremiah Nathanson reporting for the crop report just outside of Bethlehem. The barley crop looks great this year. Best crop in about 25 years, they're saying. Certainly last 10 the best. And it looks like the last 10 years of drought and bad weather that have impacted the crop are no more, and the barley harvest looks great. I actually heard that people are coming back because the famine seems to be over. So this is really good news that the crop is looking this good. So for the crop report, Jeremiah Nathan's reporting. Back to you.
Welcome to worship. Call to worship is printed. It'll appear on the screen with me or was also emailed out. And we invite you to respond with the bold print. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
God of the past, who has created and nurtured us.
We are here to thank you.
God of the future, who is always ahead of us.
We are here to thank you.
God of the present, who is here in the midst of us.
We are here to thank you.
God of life, who is beyond us and within us.
We rejoice in your glorious love.
Let's pray together. The prayer that will appear on the screen was also emailed out. Let's pray together in unison. God of grace, you have given us minds to know you, hearts to love you, and voices to sing your praise. Fill us with your Spirit, that we may celebrate your glory and worship you in spirit and in truth, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's continue to pray, praying that God would forgive us as we confess to him the things that we have done wrong in our lives. God of grace, we confess that we have not always followed you well. We have not listened to your voice. We have been cruel to those around us. We have ostracized the stranger. We have looked down upon those who are different than us. But we rejoice that you invited us when we were strangers. You welcomed us when others looked down upon us. Help us to live your pattern of love and grace, of welcoming those who are different, of showing care and compassion to those who are other than we are. These things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Hear the good news. It's in Jesus Christ that we have been forgiven. Let's know the good news that we are forgiven and can begin again as people who follow Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you. I wonder if this is a parable. It might be, because parables are precious, like gold. And this box is gold. It looks like a present. Well, parables are like presents. They've already been given to us. We can't buy them, or take them, or steal them, because they're already ours. There's another reason this might be a parable. Look, it has a lid. Sometimes parables seem to have lids, but when we lift the lid of a parable, there's something very precious inside. I wonder what this could be. It's so green. It's kind of in the shape of a square. Maybe it's a blanket. Or perhaps it's a rug. I'll see if there's something else that can help us. There's this. I think that could be a table. Once, there was someone who said such amazing things and who did such wonderful things that people began to follow him. And as they followed, he told them about a special kingdom, the kingdom of heaven. But they didn't understand. They had never been to such a place, and they didn't know anyone who had. So one day, he said, "The kingdom of heaven is like this. Once, a person invited many people to a great banquet. And when the feast was ready, the servant went and said to the guests, "Come, for all is now ready." But they all made excuses. The first one said, "I just bought a field, and I have to go and see it. Please excuse me." Another one said, "I just bought 5 yoke of oxen, and I have to go try them out. Please excuse me." And another said, "I just got married, so I can't come. Please excuse me. When the servant told the master said, quickly, go out into the streets and the alleys of the city and bring in the poor, the crippled, the blind, and the lame. But there was still room. So the master said, go out to the highways and the roads and get people to come, for my banquet must be filled. I wonder how it felt to be invited to this great banquet. And I wonder if these people have names. I wonder why these people came and the others wouldn't. I wonder how the master feels about the guests. I wonder how the guests feel about the master. I wonder how many could really be around this table. I wonder if you have ever been near this table like this, a table like this. I wonder where this table might really be.
Let us pray. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word is proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. So we will read now from Ruth, chapter 2, verses 1 to 9. Now Naomi had a relative on her husband's side from the clan of Elimelech, a man of standing whose name was Boaz. And Ruth, the Moabitess, said to Naomi, let me go to the fields and pick up the leftover grain behind anyone in whose eyes I find favor. Naomi said to her, go ahead, my daughter. So she went out and began to glean in the fields behind the harvesters. As it turned out, she found herself working in a field belonging to Boaz, who was from the clan of Elimelech. Just then, Boaz arrived from Bethlehem and greeted the harvesters. The Lord be with you. The Lord bless you, they called back. Boaz asked the foreman of his harvesters, whose young woman is that? The foreman replied, she is the Moabitess who came back from Moab with Naomi. She said, please let me glean and gather among the sheaves behind the harvesters. She went into the field and has worked steadily from morning till now, except for a short rest in the shelter. So Boaz said to Ruth, my daughter, listen to me. Don't go and glean in another field, and don't go away from here. Stay here with my servant girls. Watch the field where the men are harvesting and follow along after the girls. I have told the men not to touch you. And whenever you are thirsty, go and get a drink from the water jars the men have filled.
It's a story that's been told 1,000 times, maybe more than that. Story of people who found difficulty, economic difficulty in the land they came from. Famine, hardship, difficulty. They heard that next door in close country there was food. They went there to find food, leaving what they knew. Maybe it took months of arguing and discussing and planning and thinking, but finally they'd had enough.
and they went to the country next door, or a couple countries over, to find food. And when they got there, it started out pretty well. There was food, which was good. And it felt like they were settling in. And then tragedy struck. Difficulties happened. And they wondered if they'd made the right choice. And finally, eventually, after tragedies had taken their toll in their lives, they headed back home, chastened, broken, lost. And that is the story that Ruth chapter 1 tells us. It's not unique. It's not brand new. It's been around for a very long time. Elimelech and Naomi and their two sons had left Israel because there was no food. They'd gone to Moab where there was food, and things had gone well at the beginning. They felt welcomed, even in this strange country that wasn't theirs. So welcomed, in fact, the two sons found wives, Ruth and Orpah. Now, marrying Moabite women meant that maybe there wouldn't be any Jewish culture for the grandchildren, but that's a price that Elimelech and Naomi were prepared to pay so the next generation could be fine. And isn't that the way it is so often with refugees? It's about the next generation, or the generation after that. Sacrifices made for the next generation. And then tragedy struck. The two sons died, and Elimelech died, and Ruth was left alone in a country that was not her, and Naomi was left alone in a country that was not hers, among people who did not understand her culture, and with two daughters-in-law. And then Naomi heard there was food back home in Bethlehem. She decided to go back. At least she'd be among people who knew her. Yes, she was broken. Yes, she was chastened. Yes, yes. But she'd be with friends. And so she headed home. And Ruth and Orpah went with her, even though Bethlehem was not their home. And partway down that journey, Naomi turned to the two of them and said, "Go home. Your mother's homes. Go back home. I've got nothing to offer you. In my homeland, which will be a strange country for you, I have nothing for you." And Orpah decided to go home. But Ruth, in powerful promise and commitment, said to Naomi, "Your people will be my people, and your God will be my God. And where you die, there I will die and be buried." Powerful words of commitment. Now, a sideline here just for a moment. Why did Ruth make that commitment? What motivated her? We don't know. The Bible doesn't tell us. So frequently, in these moments of profound commitment, the Bible is completely uninterested talking about motivation. Far more interested in the promise made. And Ruth had made a grand promise. And Naomi, realizing that she was not going to change Ruth's mind, they go on to Bethlehem. And when they get there, Naomi, whose name means pleasant, that's what her name means, turns to her friends, her old friends from Bethlehem, and says, "No longer call me Naomi, call me Mara," which means bitter. Because she goes on to say, "The Lord has dealt bitterly with me, and I have a bitter pill," it's like paraphrase, "to eat." Wow. She goes on to say, "I've come back with nothing." Ruth's sitting right there. "I have nothing." She's bitter. Deeply, deeply bitter. Ruth. She recognizes that they have to have a way to live. And so she says to her mother-in-law, I should go gleaning. Now, gleaning is not a word we use these days very often, but this is how it worked in those days. Landowners were instructed by the law of God to not harvest every corner of their fields and not to pick up those pieces of corn, those straws of corn, those stalks of corn that fell, or stalks of wheat that fell. They were to leave them for the gleaners, the poor, to come and pick and have some food. That was a pattern that was to be followed, so the poor could have some food. Now we know that not every landowner allowed gleaning in their fields. Not every landowner was kind to those who gleaned. Gleaning was not only hard work, back-breaking work, it was also dangerous work. Particularly as often it was women who were the gleaners and the male workers harassed them. So Ruth knows she's going into a dangerous, potentially dangerous job, work. Hard work. And so Naomi warns her, be careful, or Ruth goes. And Ruth works and arrives in a field and begins to glean there. It so happens that this is Boaz's field. How she got there, God guided. Now another tangent for a moment. We'll come back to this maybe in the second part of the sermon as well. While God is present in the book of Ruth, God is named and God is present, God never speaks in the book. Never says to Ruth or Naomi or Boaz, do this. They know God's commands, they know God's presence, but God never speaks. God is silently present. We call that providence. We talked about that earlier in this series. And Ruth ends up in Boaz's field. And Boaz is someone who believes in allowing gleaners. So she's arrived in the right field. And she works hard. Boaz recognizes her hard work and is gracious and generous to her. And after that first day, she comes back with much barley, and Naomi is amazed and says, keep working in that field. So what does all of that say to us, other than being a really interesting story? We live in a nation where many people come as immigrants, as refugees, and virtually all of us who are going to be watching this are among people who really are boat people. Many of us have not been here for more than 3 or 4 generations. My family has been in North America for 7 generations, and I'm quite proud of that fact. But 7 generations, that's not very long in comparison to the First Nations peoples. No, we all in some way, other than the First Nations, are immigrants, newcomers. Boat people. As new boat people, as new people arrive, as new immigrants arrive, the question is, how do we respond to them? How do we treat them? Do we show them care and compassion? Now, the models of gleaning don't work very well in our day and age, but we have other ways to show care and compassion, to reach out to those who are poor and broken, arrive in our country. The Bible is really, really concerned about hospitality. And the book of Ruth, among other things, is about how to be hospitable, how to show grace and care and compassion to those who are different than us. And I know that's not easy. I know it takes challenge to do those things. but I have a colleague who loves to proclaim the gospel of Nike. And the gospel of Nike is just do it. That's what grace and compassion look like. Just do it. Actually, Boaz doesn't need to do much, does he? Just leave some stuff standing in his field. Often grace and compassion are ordinary things done ordinary ways that really are quite simple. And we are invited to just do it. May God give us the strength, the perseverance to just do it in showing hospitality and grace to others. Amen. Talking about today is in that genealogy. And we're not going to do the whole thing because that would take more than the time we have, but I just want to talk really briefly about this particular moment of these three generations of Boaz, Boaz's mother, and then Ruth and their offspring. So Boaz's mother was Rahab. That Rahab. Yeah, the one you're all thinking about. The Jericho Rahab, the prostitute Rahab, the one from outside Rahab. That Rahab is Boaz's mother. A strong woman of faith who came from outside of Israel to become part of the genealogy of Jesus. And Boaz marries a woman, strong woman of faith, from outside of Israel, who become a follower just like Rahab had. Isn't that cool? Isn't that astounding? Two generations of women in Jesus' genealogy from outside of Israel who come into the family of God, who become people who through faith and grace are in the genealogy of Jesus Christ. The genealogy reminds us that surprising people get invited in, become part of this family. Thanks be to God.
And now we'll read from Ruth chapter 4, verses 1 to 10. Meanwhile, Boaz went up to the town gate and sat there. When the kinsman-redeemer he had mentioned came along, Boaz said, "Come over here, my friend, and sit down." So he went over and sat down. Boaz took 10 of the elders of the town and said, "Sit here," and they did so. Then he said to the kinsman-redeemer, "Naomi, who has come back from Moab, is selling the piece of land that belonged to our brother Elimelech. I thought I should bring the matter to your attention and suggest that you buy it in the presence of these seated here and in the presence of the elders of my people. If you will redeem it, do so. But if you will not, tell me so I will know, for no one has the right to do it except you, and I am next in line." "I will redeem it," he said. Then Boaz said, "On the day you buy the land from Naomi and from Ruth the Moabitess, you acquire the dead man's widow in order to maintain the name of the dead with his property." At this, the kinsman redeemer said, "Then I cannot redeem it because I might endanger my own estate. You redeem it yourself. I cannot do it." Now, in earlier times in Israel, for the redemption and transfer of property to become final, one party took off a sandal and gave it to the other. This was the method of legalizing transactions in Israel. So the kinsman redeemer said to Boaz, "Buy it yourself," and he removed his sandal. Then Boaz announced to the elders and all the people, "Today you are witnesses that I have bought from Naomi all the property of Elimelech, Chilion, and Mahlon. I have also acquired Ruth the Moabitess, Mahlon's widow, as my wife in order to maintain the name of the dead with his property, so that his name will not disappear from among his family or from the town records. Today you are my witnesses."
I confess with this second part of the sermon, we are going to be dealing with some pieces of Hebrew culture that are going to sound really weird to our ears. But they are really important in terms of understanding the theological implications, or some of the theological implications of Ruth's story. But let's deal with the human side of this, the human challenge side of this, and then see how that unpacks theologically. Naomi, who has Ruth now with her, has a challenge. Because when Naomi dies, Ruth will be a stranger in a strange land with no place, no status in that culture. We're talking about the ancient world. We're not talking about Canada in 2020. And in the ancient world, there was no old age security. There was no guaranteed income supplement. And Ruth, as an unmarried woman with no children, had no pension plan because children would have been her pension plan. She is a stranger from outside. She has no family. And so she is at risk. And Naomi recognizes that. But Naomi has a trump card in her back pocket. This thing called the Kinsman Redeemer. And we'll unpack some of that in a moment. But why Naomi has this trump card in her back pocket is that by God's guidance, Ruth has ended up gleaning in Boaz's field. And Boaz is an unmarried adult male who is part of Elimelech's, Naomi's husband, Ruth's father-in-law, part of that family, and therefore he is eligible to be a kinsman redeemer. As I said in the first part, God never speaks, God never directs overtly, but clearly Ruth ends up in Boaz's field by God's guidance. And Naomi now realizes she has a way to provide support for Ruth long term. And more than that, which we'll get to again. And so Naomi plays matchmaker, and that part of the story you can read some other time. That's chapter 3 if you're interested. Boaz recognizes that he wants to marry Ruth. to be, therefore become kinsman-redeemer. The way kinsman-redeemer worked was this. I'll use myself as an example, okay? Because it just makes it easier to tell the story. So Debbie and I are married. We have no children. I know we do, but just this makes the story. We have no children. I die. That means that my brother, if he is unmarried, is expected to marry Debbie and take on my debt and my responsibility and become her husband and support her. And we say, what? This is completely bizarre. Yeah, in Western terms it is. But we've developed this picture of love and marriage, which is about romance and courtship. And we look at arranged marriage and this kind of arrangement that existed with Kinsman Redeemer, and we think that marriage there looks like a business deal. Well, I want to challenge that in a moment again, and realize I probably have a whole pile of stuff I'm going to talk about in a moment, but we'll get there, I promise. Why do it this way? Well, widows had no status, had no place, no standing. They had to be supported somehow. And in a world that recognized that it wasn't just, the marriage was not just about the couple, but was in fact about the family, the widow has become part of the family. And to ensure that her support went on in an intentional way, the brother or next closest unmarried relative was to marry the widow. And this, in fact, is love. For how many of us have ever been in a situation where we have been on the outside looking in? Maybe we became the third wheel among a bunch of friends, and we were the stranger looking in. Or we moved to a new school, and suddenly the cohort that we hung around with was gone, and we were the outsider. Or we found ourselves at a dinner party standing in the corner, and no one was talking to us. And maybe we felt that way in our lives. Ostracized, locked out, ignored, had no place, lost. And then someone came along, and out of mercy and compassion, out of responsibility maybe, walked with us. Cared for us, welcomed us in. I remember as a teenager being told by my mother that I should go make friends with someone who was actually being ostracized at school. And I said to her, but I don't like him. And she said, too bad. Build a connection. And guess what? It grew into a friendship. And yet we look at what the kinsman redeemer was supposed to do, and we say, how can that be love? But commitment, and companionship, and those things can grow into that. And those marriages did work. But they worked not just on a human level, not just about providing supports and care, but there's something deeply theological here. Because the kinsman redeemer is like this onion that continues to be needed to take it parts apart so you can see what's going on deep inside. Because not only did the kinsman redeemer become the spouse, the husband. If any children were produced by this new marriage, those children were legally understood to be the children of the deceased husband. They legally were his. And the kinsman-redeemer lost their line, lost their lineage, their heritage, to produce children for the deceased, to give that line life. And again, we think that sounds strange. But Paul says, once we were dead in our trespasses and our sins, but God made us alive in Jesus Christ and gave us new life. The kinsman redeemer gave the deceased husband new life. The kinsman redeemer took the place of the deceased, and the line was continued. Life was given. And so theologically, Jesus has become for us our kinsman redeemer. When we were dead, when our line was no more, when we had no future, Jesus comes and becomes for us our redeemer. The one who makes a new line for us, who gives us life. In Vacation Bible School on the Thursday, we talked about the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And one of the things that the curriculum really invited us to think about was that in Jesus Christ we have been given eternal life. Life on the other side of the grave. Again, we're back to, we were dead. We're given new life, new reality. And so we come in the book of Ruth at the very end to this strange line where we are told that Obed, who is Naomi and Boaz's son, is placed in is Ruth and Boaz's son, is placed in Naomi's lap, and Obed is called her son. Why? Because the line's continued. New life has been given. She was dead in bitterness, dead in her grief, lost. And a kinsman redeemer has given her new life. New hope. The line will continue. Boaz's actions, yes, save this family in human terms. But as a metaphor, as a picture of what Jesus Christ has done for us in giving us new life, in redeeming us, giving us hope. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Let's pray. Oh Father, thank you. Thank you for your presence, Lord. Thank you for your love, for your care, for your compassion. We thank you, Lord, for the Lord Jesus Christ, our own kinsman redeemer, who took us in while we were yet sinners, Lord. You brought us to yourself as strangers and foreigners, but no longer without a family, without you, Father, without a father. And so we praise you today for that. Lord, we think of our church family this morning. We thank you for each one, Father. Each one living out this COVID time to the best of their ability. And so, Father, we ask that you will show yourself in different ways to each one, Lord, because you are in the business of meeting the needs. And Father, help us to be more sensitive to those around us who may have a harder time, especially shut-ins, those who are maybe not well. that we would be, Lord, your hands and feet and mouthpieces. Thank you, Father. Lord, we also remember this week the family of Tori Stafford, a young girl who was abducted and who lost her life a few years ago, and today would be her 20th birthday. And so we think, Lord, of that family left in grief and mourning. And Father, we pray for this Stafford family in a special way today, that you would surround them, Lord, and embrace them, and that they would know your love and compassion also. Father, we thank you that we can come to you at any time, Lord, with anything that's on our hearts, with desires, our desires, wishes, dreams, because you are an approachable Father, and we thank you for that, Lord. We praise you this morning. Lord, we ask that you will help us to grow nearer to you, Lord, that you will help us to get to know you more. Lord, plant that hunger for you in our hearts today and tomorrow and the next day and the day after and so on. Father, we want to grow in grace and in the knowledge of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father, for who you are and for what you continue to do all the time. We praise you and we love you. In Jesus' name we pray this morning. Amen.
Let us pray in the words that our Lord Jesus Christ taught us. Let's pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. So just some announcements and some updates about where we're at this week, and to just remind you about the community of faith that continues to gather. So as you know, we intend to open for in-person worship in September. We'll get more details to you about that. But we are gathering for small groups. So there's a Bible study on Monday nights, prayer gathering in the prayer garden on Tuesday evenings. I know there are another couple groups that are gathering. And Chris has some stories about other groups that are gathering to do stuff here at the church.
Yeah. Hey, everyone. We've got VBS running this week. You know, the masks and the spray and the distance and all the rest. But it's really good to be together with the kids. It's something I have missed. So just a small encouragement. God's people are gathering together and spending time in joyful praise with masks on at distances. A few other VBS notes. We will have a virtual one ready soon, so perhaps next week for those of you, and rightfully so, who are cautious about sending your kids here. And secondly, it is stage 3, so in the works is perhaps another VBS or kids camp near the end of August, if things are feeling settled and our families are feeling like they could entrust kids to the church here. And we'll do a good job at being safe and all the rest. One other brief note from me. Thank you for supporting the El Salvador Sausage Drive. Those kids are really excited to be able to work and to fundraise and to feel God's leading in this mission. And finally, maybe just from me, I know and happily have been invited to one or two backyard picnics from members here at the church. It's lovely to see that the church family here at St. Andrews hasn't forgotten one another. So keep up the good work. Keep being the church. Keep celebrating Jesus Christ, who calls us out of darkness into his wonderful light. I'm going to duck out of the frame, and you take the light.
And I just have, I guess, two really quick other additional announcements. One is to say thank you for the support that we continue to receive, financially, prayer support, people calling, sending emails of support. So thank you very much for that ongoing support. And you'll see in the bulletin an update about where we stood financially at the end of June. The other, and I feel a little weird about making this announcement, but I think it makes some sense. As many of us know, the economic lockdown, shutdown, has had an enormous impact on local small businesses. And there's a campaign across Canada to encourage people on the 25th of July, Christmas in July, the 25th of July, to just go shopping locally, to just support local businesses. And so I invite those who might think that's a good idea to think about doing that. But again, thank you for your support, prayers, and encouragement, and God bless you this week. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship and communion of the Holy Spirit is now and forevermore. Amen.